Like it's waiting in your head too.
See, that's what I
said. Wait, what is going on?
Alright, calm down.
This is what I do.
Calm down, like, calm down. Start from the top.
Okay, now we're here.
Doesn't have shoulders.
Does he need shoulders? Does every man don't have shoulders? I'm gonna show you out here.
They need shoulders.
That's really too small for them. It's fine.
Make him look like a turtle.
Be Ron Swanson, a little thick neck.
Okay.
There.
Still doesn't have shoulders.
It's fine, just leave it.
What is this?
Just leave it.
Just leave it.
Just start like this.
Make him fat.
Bailey.
Yeah, give him plenty of space in the middle, because we're gonna write stuff on the inside.
He needs a good stomach.
He's fine.
If he's as one big as loser, you're
perfect.
Yeah.
That is awesome. Now,
that's
divide it right down the middle. Draw a line right down the middle.
It's not really even, but.
That's good. Okay. All right, rest of the class, shoot ideas at them. And the phones can be put away now, upside down, David, so it's not a distraction. Okay. On the right side, we will put good qualities. So what are qualities that make a person good? And you guys are going to write what they tell you inside of the figure.
Uh-huh. On the right side?
On the right side.
Okay.
His, well, whichever side. You choose a side.
I want him to be the good side.
He's beside him. Okay.
Link just inferred that the other side would be bad.
I just didn't feel like writing good on the other side of the chair.
So what are some qualities that make a person good?
Forgiveness.
Okay, forgiveness. We can put that up there.
Where do I write? Anywhere?
Yeah.
Like it's a
kindness.
Respectful.
Honesty.
Loyal.
Roberto, any thoughts? Give him one. So what do we have up there? Can you read them off? Read them off?
Forgiveness, kindness, honesty, loyal, trustworthy, respectful.
What? It's a good working list. Anything else? What makes a person good?
Hard working.
Promptness.
Not being late.
I know. I'm trying to decide to look good.
What, were you lately?
Yeah. Yeah, if there's an amendment later, we're going to have a fun time.
Now, those qualities in Aristotle's language are called what? Or in philosophical language in general, what do we call those?
Virtues.
So put that up under the word good, virtues. Virtues are inward dispositions that you have as part of yourself, whether you're acting on them or not. They're part of who you are. And Aristotle writes a lot about virtues and how we acquire them and what they mean. All right, let's flip it around. What are some bad qualities? What would be the opposite of each of those? Sister?
Selfish.
Selfishness, great. What's selfishness the opposite of? What are some other bad qualities? Think of people you really dishike or you think are bad people.
Dishonest.
Tim?
Dishonest.
So these are nouns. We use nouns to name virtues. Virtues and vices.
Rude.
Rudeness.
What addictions do you consider bad? Are bad people?
Addictions. You can put addiction up there. Sister, say anything, please.
Unfaithful.
Unfaithful or infidelity. Infidelity.
All right.
Good.
Judgmental.
Well, Beyonce songs.
That's interesting. Any other thoughts? Laziness, good. Okay. So, bad qualities, what's the philosophical word for? You guys ever run across this? Vices. V-I-C-E. Great. Okay, there's a great diagram. You guys can sit down. Thank you very much. Excellent. Or you can stay there. So, how would you describe or define what a virtue is? How do you think we get virtues? Where do they come from?
The people that raise us.
Okay, so family, virtues can come from the people that raise us, our family members, guardians,
teachers.
Can we say virtue society or your environment? See, that's very Aristotelian. He thought that it's the outside things that shape who we are. So that's a very Aristotelian way of looking at it. Once we have those, can we change them?
Yeah.
How?
Your own personal morals, decide to.
So you've got to make a decision. So let's take an example. Can anyone pick an example of a vice and how you would change that?
Okay, then. You could be raised to be rude and disrespectful if you don't have good parents, and then when you get older, decide to be respectful.
How would you make that change?
You could see the effect that, like, if you're rude to everybody, you can see the effect that it has on your life, like, no one's going to want to talk to you, and then figure out what would make it easier, I guess, for you to have a better life, get a job, because you're not going to get a job being rude to everybody and be successful being rude.
Fantastic. We're starting to think ethically now, to think about ethics, human behavior and what is, and what we want it to be, and how we shape our behavior and make our own choices. So, virtues are these qualities or dispositions that are within, they're inside of us. They issue in acts. It's important to realize that virtues and actions are not the same thing. So, I might be a selfish person even when I'm not acting selfishly. The selfishness is always within me, even if I'm not acting on it. So they're two separate things. But Aristotle also thought that habits are, or virtues are habits, virtues and vices are habits that are inside of us that we can change. How do you gain a skill in a sport?
Repetition.
Practice and repetition. Same thing with virtue. So Aristotle thought that by doing repeated acts, you can practice virtue and so gain it. So let's say, for example, I'm a disrespectful or rude person. What is an act of rudeness? What do rude people do?
Not care about your feelings, so they'll like step on your toes, so to say, and they just kind of speak your mind.
Okay, so they might speak even when it's hurtful. So speaking hurtful things. Okay, so in order to change that, a rude person, so say I'm rude, like myself, would have to become aware of what those hurtful things are and then make that choice to stop saying them or to say something different. So, for example, let's say a student comes to me and they're feeling upset, and they're explaining to me why they couldn't do an assignment, and all I do is yell at them. So maybe that's rude. I have to choose to stop yelling and get out of the habit of yelling in order to become a more respectful person. So we have to choose to change our actions, but once we make that choice, we then get rid of the vice and we can embrace the virtue. So there's this kind of circular relationship between the habits and the acts for Aristotle. Habits create acts, but acts also create habits, and that's how we can change who we are. So in his book, The Ethics, book two, which I gave you a piece of in the reading, Aristotle writes about various virtues, how he understands them, and how we can gain them. We'll go over a few more slides, specifically relating to this topic, and then to call it a day. Group one already has the reading, right? So if you don't have it yet, please take a copy. But if you already do have it, it's also going to be enough. You made exactly enough for everybody. If you need one, it didn't get one. See me at the end of class. So the word virtue in Greek is arete. It literally means excellence. To have a virtue is to be really, really good at something. Athletes are a paradigmatic example. We all recognize who the excellent athletes are in any given sport. Whatever sport it is you love, you probably know who the greatest athletes in that sport are. Those people possess the arete, or virtue, of being good at that sport. So the notion of virtue really just means being very good at something. When we translate this into the sphere of morality, it means being very good at being human. So moral virtue is just human excellence. What does it mean to be an excellent person? So Michael Jordan is or was an outstanding basketball player because of his skills. An excellent human being, like all of you here, are excellent because of your virtues. So you're good at being human, just as Michael Jordan, Scottie Pippen, and Dennis Rodman were good at playing basketball. So it means being really good at something. For Aristotle, virtues, just like athletic skills, are habits which we can create in ourselves through repeated practice. So Aristotle was convinced that people can change. No one is born bad or good. We become who we are for our lifetimes by the influences on us, but also by our own choices. And we can choose to change. We can choose to change. That is one of Aristotle's most fundamental convictions. He wouldn't buy it. He wouldn't buy excuses. So Aristotle sees virtue as a habit and as a mean. Each virtue, he says, when we look at the particular ones like honesty, trustworthiness, kindness, each virtue is like the midpoint between two different vices. The vices are the extremes. So Aristotle thought that practicing virtue is kind of like archery. You're trying to hit a target. You don't want to be too far to one side or to the other. He compares it with food. We all know that we need to eat not too much and not too little. We've got to find just the right amount of food. If we don't eat enough, we'll pass out. If we eat too much, that'll bring other health problems with it. So we want to seek the mean in eating food, but that's different for everyone. So the mean in eating might be one thing for a heavyweight wrestler, something else for a ballet dancer. But both are seeking the mean, that midpoint. And that's the wonderful thing about Aristotle's moral philosophy. He realizes that everyone's different. We all have different places. That center point might be different for all of us, but it's still a center point. So if we take each virtue, let's see if we can break them down into this idea of the mean between extremes. Aristotle, in the reading I gave you, the first part of the packet, writes about courage. So courage is a virtue, right? It's a good thing, good quality. If you have too much courage, you're rash. And you do dumb things, like drag racing down Fourth Avenue in Gary at midnight. Or bungee.